I want to do a couple things today. I want to take a look at the different bachelor's degree options. No, I'm just kidding. I want to take a look at the example that we finished last time and see if you have any questions about it and how it works and all that. So we'll spend a little bit of time reviewing that. And then we'll go and we'll sort of extend, you know, a theme. The theme that we have been harping on since the start, or at least, you know, and again, it's a theme that I harp on in all my classes. It's about not repeating code, all right? And we've seen a case, you know, in your CISS 216 class, if you've taken that, the web development class, you've seen a case of how we put our CSS code in a separate file. And we do that so that a bunch of pages can share it, all right, in a nutshell. So I don't have to go in and change 100 different pages if I change one thing, if I want a lighter color of green as my background or a darker color of blue for the text or whatever, all right? So we've taken something that used to live in our page and we've put it out somewhere separate, and the benefit of that is sharing. And what we did actually last time is that exact same sort of thing, except with C# code, all right? We took our chunk of C# code, which did a calculation that we said that we wanted to have on more than one page, all right? And we put it in its own file. In this case, it was a custom class. We are then able to go and use that class on as many pages as we want. So, same idea. If anything changes about that code, we only have to change it in one spot. We don't have to go hunting down all the places where this calculation occurs. So, if the business rules change, we calculate shipping a different way. If there was a bug detected, we divided instead of multiplied in one of the steps or whatever, then we only have to go and change it in one place. All right, so that extends the same sort of thinking that we used when we took the CSS code and put it out, and now we're doing a C# code. We have another thing that we can do that for. If you remember, if you took CISS 216 in your project, I told you to make a template of what your pages are going to look like and put on that template all the common code. In other words, the stuff that was going to be the same from page to page to page. Typically, if you look at a page, you know, thinking of a very simple web page, we might have a banner, a navigation, a content area, and a footer. Now, it might get more complicated than that for larger sites, but this is sort of a basic template for smaller to medium-sized sites. Now, it very well might be that this, and this stay the same from page to page to page. You want a consistent banner, right? You don't want to confuse people about what site they're on. You want a consistent navigation. And your footer is probably going to say the same thing on every page. The only thing that's going to be different is this piece right here. Well, just by studying HTML, we have no way to solve that, really. All right? Just basically in HTML. Because every page, we can put the CSS out, we can put the JavaScript out, but there's no way to put chunks of HTML code out somewhere else so that we can reuse them. Well, today we're going to discover using ASP.NET how we can do that. All right? And there's a solution for this in PHP as well, all right, on how you can do this. And there's things you can do on the server to get around this issue, and that's what we're going to talk about. So our theme is taking a big monolith of code, and we're slowly breaking it down into components or pieces. And the advantage is then we can share those components. So let's start out by looking at the example from from last time and see if there's any questions on that before we move on to the new stuff. I wonder if there's going to be a time where I'm going to have to separate you two guys.
You're going to have to bring a squirt bottle.
Yeah. Or like, all right, use it over there. Come on now.
We'll hook it out after class. So.
That's okay.
I really hope we're in the same group next semester.
Oh, in systems?
For systems.
Oh, please. Please. You know what? I'm going to take a 5-minute break and I'm going to email Huffman now to tell him, rig the deck.
Project isn't done. Why not? We couldn't decide on a color.
Yeah, right. Oh my goodness, that would be.
You want blue, I want it darker.
That would be epic.
I would do it, Jessica. We actually like each other, we just don't agree on anything.
Nope. Just like a married couple.
Yeah, man, I don't. Just talk.
Alright, here is the example we had last time, and I'm going and I'm unzipping it, compressing it, uncompressing it, extracting it, whatever the name is of it. So I'll pop it on the desktop. I will go and open up Visual Studio. Ooh, cool. Maybe. Open website. And I'll navigate to that, which is on the desktop. And away we go. All right. Notice that we have a new folder that we didn't have before that was called App Code. If you remember when we created this, when we went in and tried to create a custom class, it suggested that we put it in there, and it seemed like a good suggestion, so I took it. All right, so I have another folder for app code, and again, that's just useful in general to organize things. I could further organize this and put the images in their own folder and the CSS in their own folder and all that, just like you would if you're doing a plain old HTML site. All right, but the code, my custom class, gets put in the app code folder. Let's look at the custom class, and in this case it's pretty straightforward. It really only does the one calculation. Again, I kept this simple because I want to get across the concept of creating a class, and I want to do it with a simple calculation. Keep in mind, this class I've called distance conversion because the aim is I would put in any method for any kind of distance conversion I wanted to do. Just in the interest of time, I'm only doing one. I'm doing convert kilometers to miles. All right, so I'm doing that. Those of you who maybe have had advanced C# or taking it could probably realize that convert km to miles could actually be a static method. All right. If that doesn't mean anything to you, don't worry about it. What is our method, though? Our method or function being synonymous, by the way. Public means that the outside world can call it, which is what we want, right? We want other pages, other files to be able to call this. Double, that represents the return value that we have. Convert km to miles, that's the name of the function, and double argkm is the argument that we pass it. Remember, associated with functions are arguments and return values. Arguments are what the function requires to do its job. All right? This function, to convert kilometers to miles, what does it need? Well, it needs to know how many kilometers you're interested in. So there's only one argument in this particular example. How many arguments will there likely be if you created a calculate tuition method for your one assignment?
I have two.
There'll be two, right? There'll be the number, and again, if you think about it, what do you need to calculate someone's tuition?
Hours they're taking.
The number of hours?
And how much per hour?
Well, specifically, you need to, in a way you're right, but I'm going to rephrase that. You need to know their credit hours, and you need to know what their residency status is, all right? And from their residency status, you're going to derive the rate that they'll get charged. So the arguments are the ingredients. They're what the function needs to do its job, all right? And again, they're represented by argkm, and that's a placeholder. All right, so we're going to write code that's going to access that, but that value is going to get filled in by each individual place that calls this function. Yes?
So for our homework, there's going to be three calculations then on this CS?
Well, you could write it a couple different ways. You could write it several different ways. You could write it to have a separate function for each of the three residency statuses. You could write it to have one function where you give it the hours and the residency status, and then it figures out how to do the calculation. All right? So, keep in mind there's some flexibility there, but probably I would have a function that did each of the, I'm sorry, that I would have one function that accepted as an argument the hours and the residency status, and then there would be code in there that looked at the residency status and decided the rate and did the rest of the calculation. If you think about your assignment, all right, and let's bring it up. Now's as good a time as any. If we look at the tuition calculation. Let's spend a minute to analyze this. All right? All right. One credit hour for a Lorain County resident costs $118.34. For an out-of-county resident, it costs $141.49. For an out-of-state residence, it costs $280.84. So one credit hour is that. Two credit hours is simply two times that, and that's true across the board. Three credit hours is simply three times that, and it's across the board. Okay? So for each one of them, you have a tuition rate, and from 1 to 12 credit hours, all right, is that tuition rate times the number of credit hours. So that holds true for 1 through 12. All right. So the calculation is the same for all three groups. The only thing that's different is the rate. Okay? So that's sort of a hint about how to proceed on this. Now, what about from 13 through 18? 13 through 18, if you notice, is a constant. And it's a constant in all three categories. And it is simply the amount of the rate times 13 hours. So, in other words, this is 13 hours. This is 13 hours. This is 13 hours. At the appropriate rate, at the normal rate that we show up here. 14 through 18 gets charged the same amount as 13. And that's true for all three scenarios. All right? So the calculation for all three of them is that you take their rate times 13. That's the calculation for all three of them for the range 13 through 18. Finally, 19 and up, we start adding back in that rate. So essentially what we're doing is for 19 credit hours, we're charging 14 times the rate. For 20, we're charging 15. In other words, we're taking however many credit hours they have,
and subtracting 5 and then charging the rate. So there's two tests that you have to perform. One is to test the tuition, the residency code. All right. What are you going to do? Why are you going to test the residency code? What is the result of testing the residency code?
You're going to set the value of each credit, like how much each credit's going to cost.
Right. You're going to define the rate for this particular student. So if you had a variable for rate, you'd have a series of if statements or a switch statement or however you want to do it, and based on the type of residency, you would set that rate, you'd set that variable to the appropriate rate. So you have a block of code, and again, you could do this a whole bunch of different ways, but just thinking through logically, first thing you want to know is you want to know what that hourly rate is. And if the hourly rate, in-county resident, the hourly rate is one thing. If it's an out-of-county resident, the rate is another. If it's out-of-state, the rate is a third value. So, okay, now you have the rate. The next thing you want to do is you want to figure out what zone they are in as far as credit hours. Because the credit or the tuition calculation, all right, falls into three zones. For 1 through 12, it's simply flat out hours times rate. So that's easy. For 13 through 18, it's simply 13 times the number of hours. And finally, for 19 and up, it's the hours minus 5 times the rate. So once you have the rate, you calculate all three columns the exact same way. You determine what zone it's in, the 12 or less, 13 through 18, 19 and up, and then you apply the proper formula based on what zone the person falls in. So the calculation, even though it looks like there's three different calculations, there's really only one calculation, one rule for calculation. What varies is different groups get charged a different rate, and there's the calculation fits into one of three zones depending on the credit hours. So that's kind of talking through how to do this. So you're going to have some conditional statements, some if statements. You'll have a set of if statements to decide what the rate should be. You'll have some if statements to decide what zone they fit into, what region of that chart they fit into, and you'll apply the appropriate calculation. When you're done, no matter how you calculated it, you should have the tuition as a double, and that's what you return. Now, my suggestion for all these homework assignments or real-life projects or whatever, is don't try to do it all at once. All right? Let me repeat that. Don't try to do it all at once. So many times I'll get people showing me these lines of code that they obviously spent a lot of time working on. You know, it's not something they dashed off. They gave it a shot and they worked on it. But they try to do too much in one shot. So how might I approach this? I might approach this by creating my user interface, all right, putting in the validations and all that just to get that to work. I then might approach, and then creating my class and putting my function in there, I then might approach it to have it do the calculation for in-county no matter what type of person I send it. So I'll call the function and I'll give it in-county, out-of-county, and out-of-state, but I'll disregard that to start. Doesn't mean that's what I'm going to turn in, right? This is like sort of a rough draft and doing it in steps. So I might try to get it for just in-county people to work. So no matter what you pick as a residency code, it charges them the in-county rate. That allows me to make sure that my different pieces are talking to each other correctly. All right? That my button is wired to my code that creates my object and calls a function and gets the answer back and displays it. If you can get that going, you've made substantial progress, even if your calculation isn't right. All right? So, first pass, just take the number of hours times the in-county rate, no matter what they pick. So, disregard the residency status and disregard the three zones that they fall in. So, your code would simply look like tuition equals hours times 118.34. And then it will return that result. Okay, you're not there yet, but once you have that working then, all right, then you work on the pieces that you're not doing. And what would you need to do? Well, you need to make your code able to handle the fact that the three different residency types get charged three different rates. So you could put that code in there. So you would start paying attention to the argument of what the residency status is. And you would charge the appropriate rate. Now, even then, you're still disregarding the three different zones of that chart. You're still just charging them for however many credit hours they take. All right? So you're not there yet, even when you get that done. Once you've gotten that working, then you can start working on the final piece of it, and that is trying to determine what zone they fit in, and based on that, do the calculation. All right? So, that's my suggestion for this. Do it incrementally. Don't try to hit a home run, those of you that are sports fans. Try to, you know, don't go for the long bomb. You know, Woody Hayes, grind it out. 4 yards in a cloud of dust. All right? Just work through it a little bit at a time and sort of make progress towards your goal. That's good for so many reasons. All right? That's good on a technical level because let's say my code worked when I was calculating for Lorain County residents and I was always using that rate. Then I try to put some code in to account for the other groups, and all of a sudden my code doesn't work anymore. Well, I can be reasonably confident that I made a mistake somewhere in the new block of lines that I've added into that function, right? If I have a giant 100-line function that I've never tested at all, and I run it the first time and it doesn't work, I have no idea where the problem is. It's anywhere in that needle's anywhere in that haystack. Whereas if I do it incrementally and do it a few lines of code at a time, all right, I can test and I can see exactly where it blows up. Remember that you have the debugger. The debugger allows you to systematically go through and see step by step by step exactly where the calculation is working and so on. All right, or where the calculation is not working. All right. It's also good for your attitude. I mean, seriously, when you go home, let's say you work on this in lab and you work on it for an hour and you are, you have 20% of it done, but that 20% is 100% correct. That's a much better position to be in than have 100% of it done, but only 20% of that is correct. All right? Seriously, because, you know, you've accomplished something. I don't have the whole assignment done, but I have that piece of it done. I've wired my user interface to the business class, and I'm doing a calculation. I just don't have the details of the calculation right. I just have to fill in the details. It's almost like in a term paper, like writing an outline or something along those lines, right? You know that you need more detail if, you know, as you're writing out an outline and you write topic sentences and key points you're going to make. You know that you're going to have to supply more detail, but at the very least you're making progress towards the goal and you're thinking through what you need to do and you're positioning yourself where filling in the details should be fairly easy. All right. So that's my suggestion as far as this one goes. All right. Do it a piece at a time. Try to get one part of the calculation working. then add a piece, then add a piece, and do that as many times until everything works with it. I would also suggest systematically testing it when you're done. And I would also suggest that you do regression testing. What is regression testing? Well, what does regression mean in general terms? It means going backwards. You okay?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
That's all right.
I apologize.
That's all right. I thought you were just a big fan of regression testing, and you know, yeah, you were just so excited that we were talking about that. Regression testing, you know, regression means going backwards. So regression testing means making sure that what used to work still works. So, for example, let's say I calculate Lorain County resident correctly. Then I add the code to calculate out-of-county resident. Well, guess what? I'm going to go and I'm going to retest Lorain County resident to make sure I didn't inadvertently break something there. All right? Because it's possible. It should be okay, but it's possible that if you coded it wrong, you could go back and break something that used to work. And likewise, at each step, go back and testing it. Now, in this case, how many test values do you think would be appropriate to test this thoroughly?
How many
test values? In other words, you've completed the assignment and you've turned it in.
I'm going to say 9.
All right. And I'm going to sit down and I'm going to run the code to make sure that it works. How many tests should I perform? How many different tuition calculations should I perform to ensure that this works?
Not 9.
I would say 10 per resident.
Well, I would do it more like, I would do like 1, and then I would make sure all of the various levels worked where you subtract and add.
Okay.
So you need to put the arguments around the teens, the 13, the 12, the 19, and then you should use a value like 5.
All right,
That's outside of the validation range, okay. Rather than picking a number of what you're going to test.
Right. What I would say is minimally, I'd do 12. All right. Which would I do minimally? I'd do 12, and I'd do 13. Actually, I'd do 12, and I'd do 14. All right. I'd do 18, and I'd do 19. And I'd do it for all 3 residency codes. Why is that? Because I'm testing the borders between those groups. So if I code something wrong, all right, if 19 works, now, it's not a guarantee, but pretty sure that 20 is going to work because 19 represents the same group that 20's in. If 18 works, then I'm pretty sure 17 is going to work. All right? Again, not guaranteed.
23 again.
Right. Not guaranteed, but we're talking about like minimal testing. And 14 works, then I can guarantee, or I can be pretty sure the other ones work and so on. So that would be a minimal testing. The point is, all right, I didn't just sit down and start testing until it seems like I've done enough, all right? Or even worse, I ran it through one test scenario, and it works, I'm done. It compiled, I didn't get any errors, and it calculated 1 credit hour for a Lorain County resident, correct? Yay, I'm done. No. All right, you want to go through and you want a plan. All right, I've used maintainability as like my key phrase for the past, however long I started teaching. I'm going to add a new key phrase. It's about time. So I've taught here for 12 years. Every 12 years, I'm going to add a new catchphrase to it. And the new catchphrase for this semester, starting this semester, is systematic. All right. We want to do things systematically instead of guessing. So how are we going to test this? We're going to test it systematically. What does that mean? We're going to think about what constitutes legit test data. If we have 3 branches of code, if we have 3 different tuitions for the different residency types, then I know I got to test at least 3 things, right? I have to test at least Lorain County, out of county, out of state. In addition to those three, we actually have three zones. And so I know I have to test those three zones as well. I added the further condition that I want to test the borders of each of those zones. So I want to test not just 14, but 14 and 18. I want to test both ends of that range that's critical. So I'm going to think through what I need to test. And I'm not just going to sit down and try a few. Yep, looks like it works. All right, I'm going to go in and I have a plan. I have a test plan in mind for this code. Questions? All right. Let's go back, and I do want to review the rebug, the rebugger. Boy, that would be a tool, right? A rebugger. It would put back bugs in that you've already corrected.
Yeah, I have that extension.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think most programmers come with that already installed.
It's the undo button.
Yeah. I'm going to go in, I'm going to deliberately make a mistake on this page, and I'll show you what I'm doing. I'm going to change that from selected value to selected index. All right. This, if you remember, is the page that takes a radio button for either a 5K, a 10K, or a 30K, and does the calculation of how many miles it is. And it should be selected value, right? Because I should be using the value of the radio button, which is 5, 10, and 30. Instead, I'm using the selected index. All right, so I go and run this.
Excuse me.
And I go in here, and I select five kilometers is 0 miles, 10 kilometers is 6.25 miles, or no, I'm sorry, 0.625 miles. 30 kilometers is 1.25? Gee, that doesn't sound right. In fact, when we tried this code, if we could try those on the other page, and we'd get the different answer, because I didn't mess that page up. So, keep in mind that one of the disadvantages of coding the way we do is the error could be in a couple different places, right? The error could either be in whoever's calling the function, or the error could be in the function itself, right? Or the error could be in the manner in which those two things talk to each other. So that's sort of the downside of component-based design, is that when things go wrong, it can be harder to troubleshoot, because the problem could be one in a couple different places. So, what kind of approach are we going to use to debug this?
A regression?
No, this isn't really regression.
The properties debugger?
No.
Identability?
No. We're going to take a systematic approach to
that.
You were working your way through it. So what I'm
going
to do is, instead of staring at the code,
which
sometimes works, all right?
And there's only two lines.
Yeah, there's only two lines here, but imagine this being a bigger program. All right, use your imagination, all right? If we could stare at this. So students typically stare at this. They may try to Google it, but in this particular case, my program doesn't work. I'm not getting an error, so it's kind of hard to Google something. It's just not working right. Or they try things. All right? Gee, maybe that's not supposed to be selected index. Maybe it is selected item. Dot selected in, or dot index or value or whatever.
Is there an easy way, I know there is, but I forget how to do it, to just ask what your variable is set to, like,
that's
value right now?
That's what I'm trying to show, the debugger.
Right, but I mean, isn't there like you can right-click on something that it will actually show you?
Well, how does it know what it's set to? This code isn't running. You have to be running
right.
the code to
if
know this.
If it's running, you can get it.
Right, okay. Right. Because otherwise, how does it know what you picked?
Right.
All right, so you got to run it through the debugger. Now again, because this is a click event which calls code in my object, I'm going to put my breakpoint here. All right, which is probably a good idea. I just clicked in this margin.
Oh, okay. There's a,
yeah. There's a little like right to the left, right? That's a good way to put it. Immediately to the left of like this, there's a blank area. Then it might be hard to see, but that's like actually like not white but gray.
Yeah.
So you click on that. And that indicates it's a breakpoint. All right. A breakpoint means that when the web server hits that line of code, it sort of goes into X-ray mode. You can see the inner workings of your code and see exactly what it's doing, where it's coming from, and all that. So, let's run this. Or debug it, rather. I'll go in here. And I'll pick one of these. I'll click the button. And boom, I'm in X-ray mode. All right. It ran until it hit that breakpoint. And now it's going to show me each line of code as it executes. All right. And to your question, can I see the value of a variable? Yes, because now it's running. Now the variables have values. So if I put my mouse over selected index, it shows me, and it might be a little hard to see, that selected index is 0. Now that might be enough for me to realize what I did wrong, right? Because it should be 5 kilometers. It should be a 5 there, not a 0. But assuming that it isn't, what I can do is I can step into, step over, and step out. Typically, the most thorough way to do it is to step into. What that will do is that will go into any function that you are calling and see the code inside that function. Step over would be if I was sure that that function is correct, I could skip over it then and not have to go through the details of it in the debugger. Now, the only thing I would say is if you're sure that function is correct, why are you not at Starbucks having a latte right now? Why are you sitting here debugging this? All right? Until you know what the problem is, suspect everything. All right? So, don't rule anything out until you're pretty sure. So, normally I F11 to step into. You can also then step out of a function by whatever the next one was. So I have F12, I guess. So I'm going to hit F11. Keep in mind that when the debugger stops here, that statement has not executed yet. So double kilometer coincidentally has a value of 0, but I have not assigned the value of this yet. So I hit F11. I'm now in this statement, hit F11 again, I will go into my conversion object. Oh, not yet, I just created it. F11 here, I'm in it, and I can go through and I can look and say, whoa, RKM equals 0, it should be equaling 5, return mile 0, that's how it's getting 0. I could do some thought, and then I could go in, and maybe at that point I would realize that, hey, that should be selected value. The point is, I just didn't sit there guessing. Something happened different than what I expected. So the computer evaluated the code in a different manner than the manner that I specified. So something's wrong. So go in and figure it out by seeing exactly what the server's doing. Now, I talked about hovering, and that's good. The other thing you can do is you can see there's local variables defined here. It can show you them. You can also go to immediate window, and I can do things like question mark KM, and it'll show me the value of that variable. So there's a lot of things you can do once you get in the debugger. Usually you're interested in following the path of variables, what values those variables have. All right. So I can then go and stop debugging. I think I know the answer. So I'll go and change this to what it should be. And I'll debug it again. And this time when I select 5K from the beginning, that selected value has a value of 5. So now when I do the calculation, notice again, this is before the calculation, so miles equals 0. Miles equals 3.125. Oh, okay, yeah, there it did it right. And then it goes back and shows it. Be sure when you're done to get rid of the breakpoints. All right, otherwise it'll bug you every time you go and debug it. But again, a systematic debugging, a systematic testing. So if you're running your tuition calculation and you're not getting the right results, all right, run it through the debugger. It will show you exactly what path it takes. This is especially valuable when you have if statements, right? Because this is a really straightforward code. It simply goes one statement after another. When you have if statements, you have different branches that you can take. And it could go this way or it could go that way. Well, follow those branches and see exactly what happens, and does that match what you expected? Probably not, because if it matched what you expected, you'd be getting the right answer. All right, or you wouldn't be puzzled why it's giving you the wrong answer. All right, questions. I spent more time on this than I planned, but that's good because I think this is valuable to cover. All right.
How did you create that new class?
I went file, new file, and then my option was down here. Class. At that point, it will ask you, do you want to put it in the app code folder? And I said yes, and then we went from there. All right. So, the next thing we're going to do is we're going to explore what capabilities ASP.NET provides for reusability of chunks of HTML code. And that comes into what are called master pages. You take a master page and you create it. And then you can have a bunch of pages use that master page as a starting point and just fill in the blanks. Kind of like we have up here. In this example, if I assume that this, this, and this are going to be constant on every web page that I have, and this is the only thing that varies, I'm going to put these things on the master page, and then I won't have to code them again on every page that duplicates that. I will instead go in and I will simply change this area here. All right? And that's what I have to change on every page anyhow, right? Because, I mean, that's what makes this page. All right? So, let's go in and let's create an application, and let's start out by making a basic master page that we can clone a couple different times. All right, so So let's go here. Steamed muscles. Windows 8 is so goofy. Why does it think I want to know about that? I mean, I am hungry, you know, but, all right.
Who puts that news article out there? I've been distracted by that a number of times. It's like, oh, what's
that? And you know what the answer is going to be? If you don't want it, you can go through the 67 steps to configure it differently. Right. All right, so I'm going to go to new website. I'm going to pick an empty website, and I'm going to pick Visual C Sharp. I'm going to put it on the desktop. Doesn't exist. Do I want to create it? And we're off. All right. Now, normally if we were doing this, I would create my home page. All right. And then I'd create any second, third, fourth pages. But again, keeping in mind that we are going to want some content to be duplicated from page to page to page. I'm going to start, instead of creating a web form, I'm going to create a master page. Because that master page, even if I'm not going to complete everything about it right now, we'll extend this example next time. But even if I'm not going to do everything, I want to create that master page so I can use it later when I create my home page and so on. So I'm going to go and I'm going to go new file. And instead of HTML page or web form, I'm going to pick master page. All right. A master page is kind of like any ASPX page in that it has a code behind with it. And I'm going to put that code in a separate file in case I have any code. All right. I may not have any code, but I could. The difference is that the web server doesn't deliver master pages. You have to have a regular web form that inherits from a master page. So I'm going to go here, and I'm going to click Add. And if I look at the code that it creates, it looks like an ASPX page, except for two things. There's two content placeholders. Alright? There's two content placeholders. What do you think those content placeholders correspond to?
Kind of like a div where you can put things in?
Right. Am I going to put anything in the content placeholder of the master page? Got a 50-50 chance. No. Why not?
Because then it'll be repeating everywhere.
Right.
So you want the to set that content.
The content placeholder, and this worked out perfect. Wish I could claim that I planned it. The content placeholder is the space on the master page that represents a placeholder of where we're going to put our actual content on every page. So it's the blank spot in our template. So this is going to get filled in on every page that we clone from our master page, not on our master page. So the content placeholder is a place where the content that's going to vary goes. So anything outside of the content placeholder is going to be the stuff that gets duplicated on every single page. So let's go here. And I'm going to put in here header. I was wondering if anyone noticed the initials that I saved this under, HKVKR. That was the first tip off.
I thought you were going to give us a challenge with that.
Okay, so that's a header. That's a header that's going to be on every page, right? I'm going to have that on every single page on my site. This is common content, so it's not in the content placeholder. The content placeholder is that little variable spot where I'm going to put this, all right? So, I'm going to have a nav, and I'm going to create, for now, I'm going to create three links . We're going to change this nav later on.
Well, this has to be Kitty, right?
Well, yeah. So this is, let's assume that my website has at least three pages, all right? A home page, a page dedicated to Hello Kitty, a page dedicated to Keith Richards. Now, what happens if I come up with a fourth page, a page where you can vote between which one you like better? Well, I would only need to add it to the master page, right? Because every page that I'm going to clone is going to clone from this master page. I'm going to go and put a footer down here, too. All right. Now, if I go and debug this, nothing's going to happen. Well, something happened. I got an error. Why? Because web servers don't serve up master pages. Master pages are used to create regular web pages, regular ASPX files, regular web forms. So those new forms are cloned from that. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to clone my three pages. I'm going to make my three pages. All right? And I'm going to do that by cloning this master page. So, I'm going to go and say file, new, file. I'm going to pick web form. Thank you. And then I'm going to click select master page. All right. Previous examples, we just ignored that because we didn't do any master pages yet. But now we got a master page. And I can click that. Add. I only have one master page, so my selection is easy. I can have multiple master pages if I want. For example, if I wanted to style all Hello Kitty pages one way and all Keith Richards pages another way, I could create a master page for each of those. Those could even inherit from my main master page, but that's a topic for next week. All right, right now we're keeping it simple and we have one master page. So I go and click this and notice what I get. I get not a full web page, but I get two content areas. What do you suppose those content areas correspond to?
Going back to the master page.
It corresponds to the placeholders on the master page. So whatever I put in this one is going to get put in the head section's placeholder. There's a placeholder. By default, you get two placeholders. You get one in the head, one in the body. You could add more if you wanted to, all right? But we're going to keep it simple and just have the one. So on my default page, I'm going to put in the content placeholder And I'll put a paragraph. Oh. Actually, this is our home page. I forgot. So I'll say home. This site will compare and contrast Hello Kitty and Keith Richards. All right. So that's the content on my home page. All right. I'm going to clone this master page two other times, one for the Hello Kitty, one for the Keith Richards page. So I'll go here, File, New, File, Web Form. I'll say Hello Kitty. Select master page. Pick the master page. Again, I get my content areas, which correspond to the placeholders in the master page. And I can put in H2, Hello Kitty, Hello Kitty is a cat.
He's a quote unquote cat. There you go.
There you go. I wish there was a way I could do air quotes in HTML. All right, so again, you could put as much content as you wanted to here, and I'll go in and do Keith Richards' page. So File, Web Form, Keith Richards, select master file, yep. I can run my home page, and that the web server can serve up. The web server can serve up a ASPX page. So, oh, look, I made a mistake. All three links are called home. I didn't even do that on purpose, but it's going to serve the point well, because this one actually is to the Hello Kitty page. This one's to the Keith Richards page. So, okay, I found a problem. Where do I fix that problem? It's in the master page. So I'll go and I will
You could have played that perfectly and said
Yeah, I know.
That's perfect, not perfect.
But the point is whether I made it on purpose or not, I changed it in the master page and every page gets the change. So, a page then, each one of these pages, the stuff for it comes from two places. Some of the stuff comes from the master page, and some of the stuff comes from the page itself. All right? So, default.aspx. This and this comes from the master page. This comes from the home page, or comes from the home page itself, the default.aspx. Likewise with Hello Kitty. This goes with the master page. This goes with the master page. This goes with the Hello Kitty page. This one, master. Richards. Yes.
Would you use like breadcrumbs to do the navigation on this?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll talk about breadcrumbs is one of the topics we'll talk about next week when we cover this. All right. Now, again, you know, this is, you know, we did very bare bones. We just did HTML. But where would I put the CSS code for this?
In a CSS file.
In a CSS file. Okay, so let's go in and let's do new file. CSS. And I'll put in a background color of pink. And I will put in font family. Now I need the link to it. Where am I going to put the link to it? I'm going to put it on the master page. The assumption is I want all these pages to look the same, so I will put them in a master page. So link rel equals style sheet.
What do you do if you want each page to have a different theme?
Okay. Good question. The question was, what do I do if I want each page to have a different theme? The answer is this. One thing I could do, as I mentioned before, and we'll talk about this next time, is I could create two master pages. So, for example, maybe you want the Hello Kitty pages to look one way and Keith Richards pages to look another way. I would then create two style sheets and I would put them in the appropriate master page for those two sections. If it was just sort of a one-off thing where I wanted, you know, maybe one page to look drastically different than everything else, I could create a style sheet just for that page and put the main one in the master page and then put the one that overrides it in each clone page, in the clone page that I wanted to change. So you could handle it a bunch of different ways. It would depend specifically on the situation that you would do. Normally, you know, you probably don't literally want every page to have its own style. You probably want to style differently based on, like, maybe the section that you're in. Or you might even want different content areas, depending on the section that you're in. Like if you go to LC's website, depending on what section you're in, the sub-navigation along the side changes. The main navigation is constant, but the sub-navigation changes. Well, again, you could do that via having a couple different master pages. So you could have a master page for engineering, a master page for health, a master page for whatever. So it really depends on the exact situation. You have tons of flexibility with this. That's where you have to. That's where, you know, you'll get the best answer if you think through exactly why it is you want to have different style sheets and come up with an answer that way.
I'm surprised since you're taking it from the master page, which has the original like style sheet, it wouldn't like override the one you put in like Keith Richards' page. Like I'm surprised that it allows it.
It is based on sequence. You are able to have multiple style sheets in there. There's also rules for what gets evaluated if you have an external style sheet versus an internal style sheet. So, for example, I could put an internal style sheet in the Keith Richards page. In fact, we'll do that in a second, just for demonstration purposes. And that would override it. With mobile devices, you're often going to want to have a couple style sheets. So it's not unheard of to have a couple style sheets on a page, and then through different mechanisms, one will get selected or the other will.
That's where the C in CSS comes from, cascading.
Yeah, that's one of the ways that you get the C in CSS. Exactly. All right, rel style sheet type equals text/CSS. And then finally, href equals stylesheet.css. So now let's go and look at this. All right, there we go. Home, Hello Kitty, Keith Richards. So we have reusability going all over the place, right? If I wanted to add a link, a vote link, I can do that in the master page. So I won't actually create the page today, but we can create the link for it. This is actually, this has to go live, right? Although I cannot imagine the comments that you would get on this. That, on the second thought, no, never mind. This doesn't have to go live. All right. So I went and added the link to the master page, and now every page has the vote link to it. And again, notice how seamless that looks, right? I mean, it very quickly and easily achieves a very consistent look and feel, all right? And again, we're back to the same thing of if I want to change something about it, like let's say maybe I want the page background to be white and the other things to be pink, I can go in and simply change the style sheet. So if I want this to be white, and these guys that have a background of pink, and with just a simple change in one place, just like in CISS 216, we get a different look. Now to your question, what happens if we wanted Keith Richards' page to look different? All right, and for dramatic purposes, I'm going to make it way different.
You put a bunch of palm trees in the background.
I could put a bunch of palm trees as a background, right? We'll do that on Tuesday. But for today, I am going to go into Keith Richards. I could make another external file if I wanted to, or I could go in here in the head area. It's content placeholder, and say style, and I'm going to make the background black.
Why is it important to be in the head area?
Because CSS code belongs in head, the head section, oh, not in the body section. Yeah.
So you're putting that right in the page.
I'm putting it right in the page because the assumption is this is the only page that's going to want it. I could put it in another CSS file, or I could create another master page and put it in that file. So,
or create a class. You could just create a class.
A lot of different ways that you can do this. Absolutely. All right. So now I look at this, and didn't do what I thought. Let me look at the master page for a second. I'm going to go and move this, because style sheets get applied in the order that they're seen. So let me try this. There we go. because I had it in a different order, yeah. Okay. So, that is, in a nutshell, master pages. The other topic that we could talk about as far as master pages, which we might do next time, will be nesting them. In other words, having a master page, then having a master page that clones another master page, and then using that to create your clones of pages. The other things that we're going to look at is different navigational elements for things like menus and breadcrumbs and that sort of stuff. So that's what we'll pick up on next time. All right. If there aren't any questions, we will adjourn the lecture portion of this and begin the lab portion. Yeah, I was just going to ask that.
He didn't watch the video. He lost. You failed.
We knew you were going to watch it.
We know you didn't watch it.